Thank you. Won't you come, come, come? Come to the one who knows you, who wants you, who wants you. So come, come, come. Won't you come? Come to the one who knows you, who loves you, who wants you. To the one who knows you, who loves you, who wants you. So come, 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 his love song steady humming on. You are beloved. You are blue. to me. You are everything to me. You are everything to me. Bread of life and bread of heaven. You are everything to me. You are everything to me. You are everything to me. Bread of life and bread of heaven. You are everything to me. You're
Thank you. We sing in the company of the elders and the angels singing, holy, holy. We sing in the company of the elders and the angels singing, holy, holy. We sing in the company of the elders and the angels singing, holy, holy. Father of hope, Father of hope, Father of hope, Father of hope.
Cinema screen was set down in front of us, and the title screen came up, and it said, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. And scene after scene started playing of the time when the Israelites were in the desert, and the first scene was when God parted the Dead Sea, the Red Sea, for them. And the Father said, I'm still in the business of parting Red Seas. I'm in the business of making a way where there is no way, of opening a way up in front of you to give you escape from your enemies. And the next scene, I saw Moses striking the rock and the water pouring forth. And I heard the Father say, I'm still in the process of bringing life out of that which appears like it's got no life on the inside of it. And in the next scene, I could see the ravens and the manna. And I heard the Father say, I'm still the God who provides. Even in the midst of the wilderness, where with the natural eye you may see that there's nothing for sustenance, that there's nothing for nourishment, I am the God who nourishes your soul and your spirit and your body. And even though you can't see it, I will provide it daily, just as I have promised. And then I saw the scenes of where he led them through the wilderness, and where the Bible tells us that not one of them became sick, where not one of them had even the soles of their shoes wear at. And I heard the Father say, I'm still the God who heals But not only the God who heals, but the God who causes people to walk in divine health. I'm still the God who sustains. Even when the elements and the environment are harsh and totally lifeless, I am life on the inside of you. And I heard him say, I'm not a man that I should lie. I'm not a man that I should lie. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. Every word that I've promised you, every promise that I've made, I will come true. Every word that I've spoken over you concerning your life will not return to me void, but it will accomplish that for which I sent it. I'm the God who brings life where there's been death. And even where the enemy is pronounced death, I bring life. If I say something lives, it does not matter what it looks like in the natural. If I speak life, then life is what comes forth. Life. Just release life. Life. Resurrection life. Zoe life. Life to the spirit. Life to mind. Life to emotions. Life to every part of your body. Life to your situations, to your finances. Life to your families. Life to your business. Life to every part of you, every part of your life. Everything that you're concerned about, I am concerned about, says God. And he speaks life. And just as when he spoke life into creation, it didn't stop on the seventh day when he rested. Life kept coming, life, life, life upon life. And that same life is what sustains everything. He holds all things together by his word of life, by that which he is, and he is life. And he says, come to me that you may have life and have life more abundantly. Life and life more abundantly. Don't settle for anything less than the life and life more abundantly that God
to our hearts.
Breathe life to our bones. Breathe life to our hearts.
Thank you, Father. Just put your hand on your heart and just thank the Lord this morning for singing and speaking and sharing his what he sees over us, reminding us of the God of the breakthrough, the God of provision, the God of power, the God who turns things around, the God who in his hands our shoes won't wear out. There's a sustenance in God. And so Father, today we just speak life into every area that needs life. We speak breakthrough into every area that needs breakthrough. We thank you, Father, you don't tire or wear or go weary. We thank you, Father, you don't sleep. We thank you, your power is consistent. Abba, Abba, Father, Abba, Father, Abba, Father, Abba, Father, Abba, Father. Thank you, Lord. 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 Well, his songs today have restored our soul. They've strengthened and encouraged us. How many of you feel strengthened and encouraged this morning through being in worship? Isn't that great? Isn't God good? Let's just give him praise and thanks. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You show up. You show up. You show up. You show up, Lord. Just as you're getting ready to take your seats, just give someone a hug, someone close to you, and you can be seated. Thank you.
Well, good morning and welcome to Jubilee this morning. Is it just me? Is it quite hot in here this morning? And I don't mean just temperature. I think that there's such a presence of God here this morning. It's awesome. So welcome, especially if you're visiting for the first time. We'd like to welcome you and encourage you to stay behind afterwards and get to know some of us and have a tea and coffee on us. Well, if the team could take up this morning's tithe and offering, that would be wonderful. And we've got quite a few notices this morning, so I hope you're listening and you're aware and acknowledging what is happening in the life of this church in the next couple of weeks. So the first one is Create School this Wednesday at 5:30. The topic is healing and deliverance, which I think, is it Fini? You're bringing that teaching on Wednesday night. And then Harp and Bowl at 7:30. And then Nightlife Acoustic Friday night is on at 7 p.m. for young adults. And then next Saturday, the 22nd of March, we have Charles Stock. So on the Saturday from 6 p.m., Charles will be speaking here. No registration is required. And then he will be here for both services next Sunday, the 23rd as well. Registration is now open for Passion and Fire with Brian Simmons. So you can go online and register for that. There are reduced rates for that if you do go online and register. So the dates are Thursday, the 24th of April at 7 p.m. Also Friday, the 25th, all day and night. And then on Saturday, the 26th, it's just the day. So you can go online and get those details and those dates if you've missed it or you want to know more information. I subscribe to Brian Simmons' Daily Devotions on Facebook, and this morning I was reading in such an awesome testimony when he and his wife... You think I'd be loud enough with a microphone, wouldn't you? Over the top of everyone. So I was reading a devotion of him and his wife who'd spent 8 years in the jungle, and just his heart for praying for people and to seeing the lost saved, and not seeing any breakthrough and not seeing people saved, and crying out to God one night saying, God, you have to do something. Otherwise, we're going back home and we're going to have to tell people that you weren't powerful enough to overcome this nation and these people. And the next day, God did such a transformation in his heart that he repented for unbelief, and then there was an massive breakthrough and revival in the village that him and his wife were in. So he has the most amazing stories and the most amazing heart and passion for God. I love what he shares. So Sunday the 30th of March also there will be a new members lunch, and so if you have joined Jubilee in the last 12 months, if you can put your name down, if you would like to attend this new members lunch. So the girls are coming around. If you can pop your hand up, if that's you, you're a new member in the last 12 months and you'd like to attend the luncheon on Sunday the 30th of March. Also in the cafe, there's apparently a whole stack of lost property and in particular umbrellas. So if you are missing your umbrella, please go next door to the cafe and go check it out. See if half your wardrobe's over there. See if one of those umbrellas are yours, or usually there's lots and lots of Bibles as well. Okay, so we're just going to hear from one person today in a testimony, and that's Jo Lever. So if she could come forward, she's back from overseas.
Welcome. It's so amazing to be back in these four walls again. So incredible. And to be back in Australia. I came home for a shower, a hot shower. It's quite incredible there. It's quite incredible. It's smoggy and filthy and busy, and I just see poverty everywhere I go. Just incredible poverty, and that's people's lives. That's not even the slum areas that we go to. So it's quite phenomenal, and I just feel the work's just beginning. I've been there 10 months now, working in the orphanage, and just making foundations, relational foundations with the woman that runs it. And it's in Manila, in Quezon City. Yeah, so we've got a medical wing, and I've been a pediatric intensive care nurse, and I now find myself just having to do all these rashes, and we've had 60 children with chicken pox, and I'm just like, I don't know, can we tube them, intubate them, sedate them? So, I mean, it's quite incredible. It's I'm learning a lot of new things. And, you know, I'm doing a course at the moment with the church that I'm over there with, and that's just helping me grow phenomenally in God. So I need that, which is great. And so I just mainly wanted just to say thank you to you all, because you've donated quite a bit of money to the typhoon, which just touched my heart when I got that email. Just more than the money, just the fact that you supported the people there and supported me there. So I just thought that was really beautiful. So thank you, everyone. Just a little bit about Tacloban. I went down about a week after it had happened, and it was just devastation. It was just you can't describe. And it's exactly the same. I don't know where the money's going, but I know a lady that goes down there weekly, and they still have no electricity. They have no internet service. They have no homes. Nothing has changed since November. So that's heartbreaking. So I don't know where the money's gone. But on our side of things, we're collecting food relief, and we're going to drive down there again, make another trip down there. But also, we had a family come up from Tacloban that we helped, a family of seven children, and the father, and they'd lost the mum. She was holding the 3-month-old baby, and a tree fell on her. The baby survived, but she died. So the family came up, and I got introduced to them because I was asked to take one of the young boys to the hospital to get tested for his eyesight, and because mother had had measles when he was pregnant. So I took him to get tested, and he was fully blind in one eye, but he was tested for the other eye and given prescription, and so I was able to go and get him some glasses, and just his expression when he put the glasses on, he was just like, "Ay!" So I took him on a carousel, and it was just incredible. And so they've had to divide their family out amongst relatives, you know, a few children here, a few children there. He's got seven children. He had to sell his only means of support, which was a carabao in Leyte, in Tacloban. He had to sell that to buy tickets to bring his family up to Manila after his wife died. So we're buying him a carabao again, and so this is where your money's going, and much, much more. So thank you, thank you.
Okay, well, the kids can go through this morning for Kids Church. Oh, hang on, we've got one more really short testimony. Sorry, guys, just staying a little bit longer.
Oh, a very short testimony. I just want to testify that Jesus is truly the bread of life. And when Izzy sang the song about Jesus being the bread of life and the breath of heaven, I really felt something left in me because I just came off a 3-day fast. And on my third day, I was sleeping. And suddenly, I could smell this really beautiful smell of fresh bread. And I thought, who could be cooking? And I looked at the time, it was only 3:15 in the morning. I said, who could be baking? And I live so far from shops. And I don't live. I was back in my old place. And I said, who could have been baking? And anyway, I started to, when I was silly, I should engage the Lord in something, but I didn't. So I started to read the scripture, and I started to pray. And when I put off the light, I felt the physical presence in the room. It was so real. I knew the Lord was beside me. You know, I just wanted to say that. And when Izzy sang about the windows are open in heaven, and I want to encourage you guys, look with your spiritual eye. The windows are truly open. 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 Just receive. Open. Open. Look. Look. Windows are open.
As soon as she said that, I could actually smell bread. I can smell like fresh baked bread suddenly. That's awesome. All right, kids, if you can go through now, take two. Go through to Kids Church. It's really strong. It's quite nice if we're hungry. That's awesome. And I'm not sure who I'm welcoming. We're welcoming Fini to bring the word this morning.
Holy. So much goodness. You know, I have shared this testimony before when Alice shared that. I was overseas 2-3 years ago, and I was in the service in another city, laying on the floor in the worship, and all of a sudden I smelled fresh bread. And I'm like, oh, that's probably, they got a big tray of communion bread that's just been brought out, and I just made all the logical excuses, and I just kept enjoying the presence of God for another few minutes, and then finally I looked up, looked around, and there was no bread in the room. It was a church of maybe 500 people, and I could still smell fresh bread really, really strongly. And we were nowhere near a bakery, nowhere near any shops. It was in the suburbs. And I just said to the pastor, can I have a microphone? I think because the bread of life just turned up. And we don't want to miss this window. And he was very happy with that. And so I asked the church, how many of you can smell fresh bread? And about two-thirds, maybe more, could smell fresh bread. And then I thought, well, okay, well, all of you, they're going to get whacked this morning. And I just had an altar call, and people got delivered, people got healed. Because the bread of life, he brings life, you know. Gluten-free. And I just wanted to, I know that the announcements were a little bit chaotic this morning. I'm not sure why. A lot of conversations going on. I want to just reiterate, encourage those of you who might not have heard that Charles Stock is with us this Saturday at 6 p.m. We could have had a day thing, but a lot of parents have sports and activities, Saturday shopping, whatever. So we thought, let's make it an evening and have it. So three meetings. We've got Saturday night at 6 and then Sunday morning and Sunday evening. And Charles Stock leads probably one of the biggest river churches on the East Coast in Harrisburg. He's Sean Foyt's pastor, and Georgian Banoff has come out of his church. Many, many great, great leaders and ministries have come out of his church. He's a real father in the Lord, and he's a father to us, Izzy and I, and an amazing man of God, and full of joy, full of life, full of humor, full of prophecies. And so I want to encourage you not to miss that. We don't do special events all the time. We do them when we select someone that we've invited. He didn't invite himself. He didn't phone me and said, I've got a free weekend. I'm coming through Sydney. We contacted him a year ago and said, please come to Sydney and be apostolic to us. Be a prophet. Speak into the life of our church. And so we don't take it lightly. Don't plan a movie for that night. Don't go on the town. Don't go to the theater or the opera. It's a night to be in the family of God. And come to all three meetings. Just plan your weekend accordingly that we can learn and grow together. Otherwise, what's the point? He's not a visiting speaker. He's a father to our church. Amen. So just give some perspective to that Charles Stock. And he's coming on a Wednesday, so we get to have a day or two with him. And then he's going up to Byron Bay and then coming back down to Sydney for the Saturday. So I'd like you to turn to the prophet Malachi. He's the Italian godfather. If you don't think he's Italian, that's up to you. You don't have to worry. I don't worry. It doesn't worry me. I know where you live. Malachi 4. Many years ago, the Pope went through a tricky time, and he had heart problems, and he wasn't going to survive without a heart transplant. And so it was put to the people in Rome at the time and wider that if they came into St. Peter's Square and that someone would be chosen to donate their heart to the Pope. And so the St. Peter's was packed, and everyone was mourning and grieving at the potential loss of the Pope. And so the second in command, he stood on the balcony and he said, I'm going to drop this feather down, and whoever the feather lands on, they're going to have the privilege of donating their new heart to the Pope to help him to live. And so throughout, the people were, yeah, take him my heart. Back to the prophet Malachi. See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. Last week I spoke about the father heart of God and how that's a foundation in our knowing him, in loving him. The Lord's Prayer begins, Our Father who art in heaven. And if that Our Father is a struggle for you, if that our Father is like, well, I prefer to relate to Jesus, I relate to the Holy Spirit, I don't really relate to Father because I've got my Father sucks or sucked, or I don't know who my Father is, I've had three fathers over my life, whatever it is, God wants to heal that wound because it's the very foundation of your walk with God. He's called Father. That's not, he doesn't think about that, that's who he is. He's the Father of heavenly lights. He's the Father of every good gift that comes from above. So if our perception of God is stingy, if your perception of God is he's a disciplinarian, if your perception of God is he's the CEO, or whatever your perception is, it'll taint your faith. It'll taint your walk with God. It'll taint your enjoyment of life. It'll taint how you perceive, how you worship, how you walk with your walk, and how you relate to other people. Because how you relate to God determines how you relate to other people. How you see yourself determines how you relate to other people. When I see angry people and frustrated people and people having a hissy fit, they're not really angry with me or you. Sometimes you've done something, you've cut them off or you've taken their car space or you've jumped a queue, whatever it is, and they disproportionately lose their joy over what you've done. They're not really angry with you. They're angry with themselves. They're frustrated with who they are, and you're the nearest thing to cop a serving of what they would like. They're angry with life. They're angry with, and you're in the way, And you're thinking, man, I didn't think that was that bad. You know what I did? Okay, I'm sorry I cut you off, and I'm sorry I took your car space, but what you're giving me is disproportionate. And they're not cross with you. They are cross with themselves. They got a broken heart. They got something inside of them that's broken. And so they see, the lens that they've got, they see you through that scratched lens. You haven't got the problem. They got the problem. And so you must just smile at them. I'm so sorry I cut you off. So sorry that I took your car space. Have the car space. I'll reverse my car out, especially for you. Give them their joy back. Amen. But this thing of the fathers and the sons, it's crucial because I work with people every day. That's my job. I work with people from every walk of life, people who have traveled, you know, through very great difficulties. And by and large, people who are struggling, people who've been through addictions, people who've been end up in jail, they suffer from fatherlessness or what's called a father wound. 70% of people in our Australian jails right now are there because of fatherlessness. Many years ago, they did an experiment and they thought, on Mother's Day, let's let all the inmates of, this is in America now, let's get all the inmates to write a card for their mothers. And so they distributed to all the jails in America, all these cards, and they were snapped up. They had to go out and send trucks to get more cards because every card was snapped up. And all these inmates of the jails, which would run into the hundreds of thousands of people, they wrote letters to their mums on Mother's Day. And so when Father's Day came around, they thought, let's do the same thing, man. And they got truckloads of cards, and they brought the cards in, and no one sent a card. No one sent a card to their father. No one. I'm not exaggerating. I just read the account. It was in a reputable magazine. Who? No, it wasn't. Women's Day. Women's Day. And so what I'm talking about today, the fathers and sons, it relates to God our Father and also relates to fathers on the earth. It relates to how we relate to each other. It relates to everything because it's the flow of life. Heaven is perfect harmony. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each of them have distinct roles. Each of them have distinct characteristics. Each of them have distinct personalities. And yet they one, and yet they defer to each other. There's no... Man, this is my day. Jesus is like, it's my day, Dad. Let me go. He just does what he sees the Father doing. The Father directs the Son. The Holy Spirit is the power moving in the earth today. They all have, they defer to each other. There's perfect harmony. And that's what God wants on the earth. So it's important we get the Father heart. It's important that we operate out of the Father heart. That we don't have an orphan spirit. And I spoke last week about the prodigals and how that and the older son, older brother, and the younger brother, and, you know, getting your inheritance early, all those things, which I can't go into again today. I'd encourage you to watch that on Ustream if you have the time. So that's the foundation. As it is in heaven, so it is on the earth. We get our vertical relationship right, it's going to influence all our earthly relationships. Insecure people, people that are stingy, people that are struggling with their identity, they're going to box you in life. And it's because of their relationship with God. It affects our relationship with each other. And I know that for many years in my life, I had an orphan heart. It wasn't intentional. I had a great dad who was a great provider, but he was absent. He wasn't angry. He paid the bills. He sent me to a great school, but he wasn't around. And what is better than money is time. So I had a great education, great clothing, great annual holidays, but an absent father. And that's a problem, because that's where you're meant to get your identity from. That's where you're meant to get affirmation from. And so a person who hasn't been affirmed is always looking for affirmation. All their life, you see grown adults acting like eight-year-olds, looking for someone to tell them that they're wonderful, that they look good, that they are special. And you're meant to get that in those first 7 years of your life. And if you miss out, it is a struggle. And so you've got to go to God and say, God, I missed out. And I got good news for you this morning. It's never too late to have a happy childhood. Come on. Never too late. Never too late. Never too late. My grandfather got baptized in the Holy Spirit when he was 95. Spoke in tongues, wept his way into the kingdom, and then went home to be with the Father. Took a while. So James Gold was in our church about 3 years ago, and he prophesied. He's a world-renowned prophet, written, I think, 15 books on the prophetic, and he had a dream. He woke up, then fell asleep again, had a dream about Jubilee, and that's why I'm speaking on this subject this morning. And in that dream, there was a building, and it was two stories, and Daryl was in the story above, and I was in the story below. And he then went on to sing the song about Father Fini has many sons. And everyone began to sing it. It became hilarious and unforgettable. And I will not sing it again. It's just a bit cheesy the second time. The first time is good. It's awesome. There's an anointing. The second time is cheesy. It just gets more cheesy after that each time you sing. But the power of that was that God was saying something to us about our future. Because the sons are meant to eclipse their fathers. The sons are meant to go further, and that's why Daryl was who represented the sons of this church, and not just a male thing. Get over yourself. Oh, I talk about sons. I'm talking about daughters as well, all right? Just, I can't keep, you know. God is also the multi-breasted one, so you get your head around that. That's what one of his names are, okay? It's just true. It's just true. So he's able to give us all our needs, mother and father, in the Godhead. Amen? I can't work it out, but that doesn't really matter. So the prophetic thing about God and what he's doing in the scriptures is he's turning the hearts of the fathers to the sons and the sons to their fathers. That's what God is doing. He started doing that when that was written. And then as we get revelation of what he's doing and we lose our orphan hearts, we become the solution to Australia. Australia is a nation of fathers and sons. Australia is not an orphan nation. Australia is a nation of sons becoming fathers. It's a nation of fathers turning to their sons. That's what Australia is. And that's the solution for our nation. Because when a nation has been broken by children being taken from their parents and by addictions and by drugs and by divorce, when a nation's broken and fractured like that, which is what we're living in, we've got to present the solution, which is fathers and sons. And you can start to be a father when you're 15. It isn't a sexual thing. It isn't an age thing. It's a relational thing. It's how you see people. It's how you view them. And so I want to speak a little bit about Jesus this morning, because one of the names that he's spoken of in Isaiah 9 and verse 6 is Everlasting Father. And because Jesus spoke so much about the Father, we always see him through the eyes of being a son. And he was such a good son. And of course he was a good son, but he was reflecting the Father. So Jesus, of course, was a father. He's the Everlasting Father. And so I want to talk about Jesus this morning and look at him through the lens of how the disciples saw him, because we're all disciples of Jesus. And it's important that we frame up both our relationship with Jesus and a relationship with each other through the language of family. That's the language. You see, you've got different types of models of leadership in the earth today. And many organizations and even churches take on the role of the CEO. You get the CEO, you get the pecking order, you get the middle management, you get directives that come from above. And it's very easy to flow like that because it's just simple. If you have clear lines of authority, everyone knows their place, their role, their definition, their function, then they can function. Clear lines of authority. Whereas in a family, it's a little more blurred. How many of you have discovered that? It's relational. You've got to work it out. There's mum and there's dad and then there's siblings and there's different age groups and pecking order and who gets to sit in the front and who gets to sit in the back and who gets to, you know, there's every day is challenging. Come on. More challenging depending on how many children you have. So I live a challenged life. But delightfully so, because that's the language of the kingdom is the language of family, and the language of the church is the language of family. That's the language. We don't have a CEO culture. We don't have a dictator culture. It's my way or the highway. That's the dangerous way to lead an organization. It's a dangerous way to lead a business. I think that business model sucks. I think if in heaven and on earth, we should be taking into the business world the model of the kingdom, which is Father and Son. Come on. Where the CEO wants the best for the sons, where the CEO is promoting people, not trampling on them to keep them down, to make sure that they don't succeed, where there's a culture of how can we let people thrive? How can we find their strengths and promote them and get them to rise up? Because the sons, if they're successful, become successful fathers who in turn will have more sons. Come on, that's the cycle of life. That's what God's got for us. So there's two major models. One is the hierarchical model where there's the CEO and he's my way or the highway kind of guy, and I've been in churches and organizations like that, and it's horrible. The symptoms of that kind of a culture is you don't ask questions. You just sit on your hands and don't put up your hand, because if your hand goes up, it could get chopped off. The fans fly very low in that kind of organization. And so there's a culture of fear. There's a culture of asking the wrong question. There's a culture of not do things right, of stringent obedience at all costs. And coming out of a South African culture, which is a very obedience honoring kind of authority kind of culture, that can be exacerbated in church, because that is just an unfortunate way, a spin-off of a predisposition in a culture. Come on. And it's unhelpful. I was in that kind of a culture for 20 years. Very unhelpful. Never ask questions. You have a million questions, but you don't dare ask them, because you are either going to be made fun of because it's the wrong question or it's a stupid question, publicly, normally, which is always less incentive to ask a question. And you don't really know anything. So you're made to feel like you don't really know what's going on. And if you have a question, you should rather sit on it, because it's not going to be the right question and it's stupid and rather shut up. And that's a very, you're going to be rebellious. So that's a very difficult culture to thrive in, because actually the truth of the matter is each of you sitting here this morning have the Holy Spirit in you, for crying out loud. Each of you. So you all know a lot more than you think you know. There's just a solution right there. Actually, you know God, you know His truth, you know forgiveness, you know grace, you know the power of God, you know about healing, you know about end times, not much, but you know a little bit. Come on. Come on. Come on. Tell the person next to you, you know a lot more than you think you know. Intuitively, you know, we meet someone, we hear something, or we're listening to a message or a tape or a CD, and you think, man, that's a bit off. But you put it down, you think, I mean, that person has a doctorate, that person, why would I know anything? As though you've got somehow a junior Holy Spirit, you know, you haven't done the third degree training and 13 weeks of whatever, you haven't done that, you missed the course. As though the disciples were encouraged that Jesus said, you wait in the city until you clothe with power from on high. I'm going to see the Holy Spirit. He'll teach you all things. They didn't have a book. They didn't have a manual. They didn't have how to build a church. Come on. This isn't the way to build church. This is the best way we know how, but it's not the way. Amen. We're just experimenting each week. What should we do next? There's no manual. What is a successful church? I have no idea. Happy sheep. A really successful church is happy pastors. That's a real success. Come on. I was meeting with someone this weekend and having dinner, and he said to me, you know, I used to be known as the happiest person in Bronte, and then I became a pastor. Did you hear that? I used to be known as the happiest person in Bronte, and then I became a pastor. I dropped to the ground. I laughed so hard because it sounded so weird. It sounded such a paradox, and yet it was true. It's so sad, but he laughed so hard. He hadn't laughed like that for years, and it made his weekend because that's who he really is. He really is the happiest person in Bronte, and being a pastor robbed him of that because he thought that being a pastor equals being serious, having it together, being organized. Come on. And that's not true. There's no manual about that. But what does a pastor look like? I've no idea. Husband of one wife, you know, happy, manages household. Not a lover of money, all those things. That helps. Amen. But you have to be serious. Do you have to be a lemon-sucking Pharisee type pastor? Is that the kind of pastor we want? We don't want those kind of pastors. Come on. Upright, not uptight. So I've had a lot of healing over the years because I was a grumpy pastor. And the people who copped it the most were those closest to me, because you wouldn't be grumpy with people, the sheep, because you want them to keep coming to church and tithing and all that kind of thing. So you just like, ha ha, how are you? How are you? People who suffer are your family, your kids, your wife. Because you've got to get to church on time. I used to take 3 trips to church. By the time the service started, I was exhausted already. And I hated all the people that were happier than me. All this latte-sipping Bondi crew. Come on. All the hipsters. Just hated them. And how sad is that? How sad are you as a pastor when the people that you're trying to reach, you don't even like them? Because they're comfortable, they're wealthy, self-satisfied. And I think God had to break my heart and teach me how to love myself and how to love people. And it came from a relationship with Him. And I'm still in that journey. I'm not there yet. I'm learning. This is a very good message. Come on. Come on. You think I'm joking? So it makes it even funnier. So turn to John chapter 13 with me. We're going to look at Jesus as a father. Wow. It's never too late to have a happy childhood. There we go. You can have it this morning if you want to. Oh. Ha ha ha. It's an interactive message. It's very interactive. Sometimes the Lord just deposits a deposit about what I've said, and you've got to actually drink it then. You're like, okay, this is the active part of the message. Drink it. Amen. Amen. John 13, have you found it yet? I found it. It's just that, is it worth actually speaking it? It was just before the Passover feast, and Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world. I'm trying. He now showed them the full extent of his love. What's the appropriate response when people laugh? Just laugh at them. It's meant to be contagious, and it's the twinklings of heaven. It's like twinkles of heaven. God just sends these twinkle moments. It's just effervescent twinkles of heaven. It's the Father of heavenly lights. That's what happens. Man. He now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. So I want to look at the 12 apostles this morning, the 12 disciples. Jesus chose them. It says he stayed up and prayed all night to the Father before he went out. And then he picked, you know, the brothers who were fishing, and he picked Luke, and he picked Philip, and he picked Judas, and he picked Thomas. He picked this very divergent group of men to follow him and to spend time with them. And he said he called them just to be with him. So it wasn't a course. He says, I want you to come and do this degree in divinity with me. And you're going to become doctors of divinity and lead the church. No, he just said, come and be with me. I know the Father so well that if you spend time with me and watch my life, you're going to learn what the Father's like. And then you're going to start the church, and you're going to proliferate this beautiful bride of Christ throughout the earth. But I want you to look at them very honestly, because here's an honest group of people. These are the church fathers. How many of you would have picked Judas and then made him the treasurer? He had money problems. He had sticky fingers. And it's not like Jesus didn't know that. It wasn't like he was shocked. Oh, you've been robbing us blind. And so his comments in this passage when Mary comes in and pours this expensive perfume second time over Jesus' feet, and this perfume fills the air, and everyone, and Judas in his heart's thinking, man, that should be sold, that money should be sold, and the money given to the poor, and I take my cut because I'm poor. You know, that whole greedy thing, that he was on Jesus' team. Jesus picked him. He chose his betrayer. Not like he was shocked by betrayal. He picked him. He picked Thomas. Come on. What's Thomas's name? What's his adjective? Doubting Thomas. That's on Jesus' team. And some of us are like that ourselves. And Jesus picked us. He chose us. Because I don't think Thomas remained doubting Thomas. Once he'd put his finger in Jesus' hands and his feet, he was like, whoa, never again. I believe my Lord and my God. Come on. He didn't stay that way. They were the sons of thunder, the sons of Bronte. The word is Bronte. Come on. Sons of roaring. They were roaring sons. But they were fiery. There was conflict in his team. There was zealots. There was people that were standing for what the other didn't stand for. There was that potential for sons in conflict. And Jesus was there to help them. And the honesty of Jesus was that many times it says he despaired. He said, how long do I have to put up with you? But then he would just have to then encourage them. When they came back and they had been out in the villages healing the sick, and it says he leapt for joy. So he spun around and leapt for joy. He was so excited that they saw the signs of the kingdom being advanced, healings and deliverances and ministry taking place. So he wasn't all heavy on them, but he was a father to them. He loved them. He drew them to himself. He was with them. And that's what fathering is. It's just spending time with people. You see, because all of you are fathers and all of you can be sons. But if you don't learn to be a son, you'll never learn to be a father. Did you all hear that? If you don't learn to be a son, you won't learn to be a father. Doesn't matter how old you are. It's not about age. It's not about seniority. It's about a heart. A heart to learn, a heart to grow, a heart to be transparent, a heart to open your heart, a heart to be vulnerable, because that's what it takes to make it through the end of your life. You look at the people in the scriptures, those who finished strong were those who had good fathers. How many know that Eli had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, no relation to me. And they were wicked sons. It says, the Bible says they were wicked sons. They were sleeping with the temple prostitutes. They were abusing the privilege they had as being priests in the house of God. And so God raised up Samuel, who was a true son. And he became a son. He became a prophet. And then David became a son to Samuel, even though they weren't physically related. David submitted his life to Samuel as a leader, as a king, as a one who would honor the word of the Lord. And that's what it takes. It just takes, can you hear the word of the Lord through someone? Is someone speaking into your life? Has someone got an idea of what's going on in your inner world? Because that's what being a son means. Not me, it's just someone. Someone who has spiritual discernment. Someone who has a spiritual walk with God. They can be a father to you. Not your father, I'm submitted to you for the rest of my life. You are my spiritual father. No, we have many fathers through our lives. Come on. It's not like you have one physical father, one biological father, but many, many of your lifetime, people who have been a father to you, maybe for a year, maybe for 10 years, maybe all your life. But I don't see in my life, I've got a spiritual father. This is my spiritual father. And I just write to him every week and submit my life to him. And, you know, what do I do? I'm going to think of getting a new car. What shall I get? No, I'm not like that. But it is good to have people around you who are fathers in the Lord to every one of you. And I look at this passage because it says as they go on, Jesus takes off his outer garment and he gets a towel and some water and he starts to pour water into a basin and washes his feet. And he says to them, from this time forward, this is how ministry will be. So ministry at Jubilee Church, what does ministry look like? Washing people's feet. That should be on our banner, our logo. Jubilee Church, foot washing ministry. Because it's a crap job. We want, no, give me the glamour. I want to see signs and wonders, and I want to see miracles, and I want to have a name for myself. I want to have some recognition. No, no. Foot washing ministry. This is Jesus said, I'm going to show you the full extent of my love, and then he washed their feet. And he said, I, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet. You must wash one another's feet. Don't get any grand ideas about ministry. Don't get any highfalutin ideas about this is what it is, that's what it is. It's some sort of, you know, a logo, a name, a ministry, a calling, some apostle, some prophet. No, no. It's foot washing. What do? I wash feet. No, but are you an apostle? Are you a prophet? Are you a psalmist? I don't know, but I wash feet regularly. Dirty feet, clean feet, scented feet, feet with missing toes, I wash them all. So what do you get out of it? I do it for Jesus. Some people say thank you, some people don't. Some people recognize that I've ministered, some people have no idea that I ministered to them, and I just ministered to them. I walk away thinking, I just ministered to you. That was amazing. Did you have no idea? No. That's because you the servant, washing their feet, it doesn't require a thank you. It's nice. It doesn't need it. Because you're not doing it for them, you're doing it for him. You're doing it for the king. Come on. Come on. You've been promoted. You've been promoted. We've been promoted. And that's the rest of our life. It's not like at one point or another, and you work your way out of. Now you have been promoted. You never have to take out the rubbish again. No, actually, you do it tomorrow and the next day. You do the laundry, you do the crap things, you do all the things that are repetitive, they mean nothing, but they just servant-heartedness. And all of ministry is that. All of it, whether it's public ministry, private ministry, hospital ministry, ministry to the homeless, ministry to the broken, I-61 ministry. Come on, it doesn't have to be anything except foot washing. We're in the foot washing business. And you just delight and you think, man, I've got more feet, Lord, give me more feet. Because when you're happy as a son, and Jesus, the Lord of the King of Glory, who didn't need to get his hands dirty, he could have had people doing, look, you know who I am? Do you know who I am? Someone get me a bloody towel, you know, come on. I'm Jesus of Nazareth, for goodness sake. I don't wash people's feet. I've got people do so for me. You see, in the celebrity world, it's like, I don't do that, we don't do that. And it creeps into the ministry world. Like, no, I wouldn't do that. I'm somebody. Well, you're just too big for your boots, man. You know. Take off your crown. Lay your crowns down. Come on. Hallelujah. He says in verse 16, I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. Say, do them. Do them. I love that part of it. You'll be blessed if you do them. It's like, oh, I thought everything's been done. All the work was finished at the cross. Yes, everything was finished at the cross except the dirty feet that still need to be washed. It's all finished. And now that we know that it's been done, the power that we received, the love that we received to do the works of God, we've got to do them, lots of them, every day. Lots of do's. Not out of the obligation, because I've got to please God. If I don't do it, God on me. No, God's happy with you if you did nothing for the rest of your life. He really is. But will he be fruitful? No. God loves fruitfulness. He even looks for fruitfulness. Will I find fruitfulness? Will I find faithfulness when I come back? He's looking for it. He's looking out for, is your life producing fruit? If your life's going to produce fruit, it means you've taken lots of feet, dirty feet, and washed them. That's what it looks like. It looks like something. It looks like action. It looks like obedience. It looks like transparency. It looks like submission. And that's the tricky part that people find tricky. And I was reading this week, and it was a little bit discouraging, because one of my heroes was David Yonggi Cho for many, many years. I listened to his messages on cassette tape. How many of you listened to cassette tapes before? You can still remember that? I still have some of them. I don't know why, because I haven't got a cassette player, but I've still got the cassettes. It's like something, some weird attachment to these early messages. But they formed my life. They formed a lot of my early faith was formed by many of those faith messages. And this guy was a legend. He planted a church that became the biggest church in the world. Up to this day, it's still the biggest church in the world. Close to 1 million members. That's pretty big, amen? That would qualify you for some sort of badge or prize. Except that he has a son who was a really recalcitrant son. Been married 4 times, in and out of affairs and misappropriation of funds. And somehow he's been got involved. The son sold the church some shares and they were overpriced and it lost the church $12 million. It's a lot of money. Amen. Now he should have known. As fathers, you need to know. When you're that bright, and you've got that many people working for you, you need to know. This is the price we're buying those shares for. I don't need to read the legal document. I want to know, is that what it's worth? Excuse me, sir, you're an accountant. Are the shares worth that much? That should be a 5-minute conversation. Amen. No, they're 4 times that much. Okay, we won't buy them then. Come on, that's what integrity looks like. Integrity looks like I didn't know, I didn't hear, I didn't ask. I have to ask. As the father, it's my job to ask. I have to ask the questions. I am responsible if there's misappropriation of funds. I need to know. The buck does stop with dad. Come on. If things are going well, give him some praise. If things go badly, he needs to be corrected. Come on. So now he's got a 3-year suspended sentence and a $5 million fine because he was found guilty. It's an anathema. It needn't be so. Why? Because sons have to take care of the fathers have to take care of the sons and train the sons in righteousness. They have to be trained in righteousness. Righteousness doesn't just happen. For whatever reason, that son was a recalcitrant, you know, prodigal son. He needed to be trained. He shouldn't have been given authority. Shouldn't have been given government. Those in government need to be above reproach, especially when it comes to finances, because the Bible says that we'll be judged more strictly than others. Because we're handling not just money, we're handling God's money. Come on. It really is God's money. Habba shabba. That just struck me there. It's like, man, that's a scary point, Finney. So, let's just look at this. Verse 18. I'm not referring to all of you. I know that those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares his bread has lifted up his heel against me. He's talking about Judas. I'm telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am he. I tell you the truth. Whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. There's a good word right there. I'm not going to get into that, but it's pretty powerful. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples said at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. Now, I'm talking about relationships, and I'm talking about sonship. And I'm talking about sons and fathers. And here's John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. He wrote this about himself. There's a bit of security right there. It's like Moses wrote that Moses was the most humble man in all the earth. You know that you got yourself securely worked out when you can write those things about yourself. And I think it's true. I think John knew that he was the beloved disciple and he wasn't afraid to write it because it was true. He wasn't saying it out of pride. He was saying it out of humility. That's who I am. But I want to know, who do you have in your world that you can lean against their chest at a meal and that doesn't come across weird or sexual? Who's in your world that you can just lounge back against them? Have your arm around them and it's not weird. These are two men at a table and John's leaning against Jesus' chest. He can feel his heartbeat. And Peter is asking John a question to ask Jesus when Jesus can hear the question. Come on. They're at the table for crying out loud. John has his head inches from Jesus' mouth. And he's still asking the question. John, you ask him. Come on. Now, there's many things going on here that I want to encourage you with because it's important that we see that Jesus had John, who was the beloved disciple, leaning against his chest. A real picture of intimacy. Do you have someone like that in your world? That you can walk into their house, you know where the spare key is, and you can sit in their lounge room, and when they come home, they're not going to be shocked or dismayed. Do you have someone that you can talk to about your darkest temptations and fears? Someone who'll pray with you, not just commiserate with you and say, you poor thing, a bit mixed up, aren't we? Someone who'll actually bring life and bring solution and bring hope. And bring direction. Come on. Because that's who Jesus was to John. He wasn't just a good mate. He was a father to John. He was a father to John. He wasn't just like, you my mate, you my chum. We can lean against. You see, me and Jesus, we like this. He wasn't boasting like that. This was a real relationship he treasured. And a relationship where John got Jesus in a way that Peter and James didn't. And you've got to realize that the things that God does in your life, you should not share with everyone. You need to be selective about who you share your innermost secrets with. Very selective. Because some people will take that information, you've shared your heart, you've bared your soul, and they'll make light of it, they'll make a joke of it, they'll tell three other people who shouldn't really be included in that information, not necessarily in gossip. Just in that, well, they think, well, if you told me, we can tell it. The world knows about it. And then you get hurt, and you get disappointed. Well, that's why you need to be selective. And that's why Jesus had John. And I believe John knew things about Jesus and secrets, because he tells the secrets to his friends, that maybe Peter and James didn't. But certainly Peter, James, and John enjoyed a relationship with Jesus that the other disciples didn't. Because he chose just the three of them when they went up on the Mount of Transfiguration to meet with Moses and Elijah. How many know that was a pretty hectic encounter? They were there. Moses and Elijah appeared with them in the fire, in the glory of God. They were so wrecked by it. They were, let's build a memorial stone. This is like, what? This is crazy. So Jesus was inviting them into an encounter with him. That's pretty amazing. Pretty special. You might have just two or three people in your life ever that you can share that level of intimacy with. And that's not a bad thing. That's a good thing. Maybe you haven't got that person yet. It's good to say, Lord, I want to have that person. When you see people going off and having a fun time and, well, they're laughing and they're joking and you're not in the inner circle, don't envy them. Just find your own inner circle. Don't wish you were in someone's inner circle. If they haven't invited you, you're never going to be there. Just don't worry about it. Just say, Lord, I thank you that I'm going to be a son and I'm going to be a father. That if I'm lonely, if someone's not in my world, if I'm feeling left out, maybe others are too, I'm going to start enlarging my world. I'm going to enlarge my world. You need to have boundaries about what you share, but you need to have someone that does know exactly who you are. What makes you tick? What are those amazing encounters you've had? Who are you telling those encounters to? God wants to help you to share your life. And then there was the 12. The 12 spent a lot of time with Jesus. They were really there with him in the miracles. They were there with the feeding of the 5,000. They were there at the end. Jesus spent all his time with them. Then there were the 72. Who were they? They're your Facebook friends. They 72 others. We don't know who they are. They have names. We're not sure who they are. They're friends of friends. We added them. They've all been added. But you don't know them. You don't show your heart. You don't process your pain with them. They don't disciple you. You don't disciple them. You just share fun things, what you eat, where you go, your holidays, da-da-da-da. And why not? Amen. As he shares poetry, she shares life things, and a lot of people benefit from that. It's a great flow of life, but it needs to be a flow of life. If it isn't a flow of life, cut it off. That's good. I want to cut everything off. Anything in my life that does not produce life, you can cut it off. I just don't want to have stuff that's draining me and taking life from me and creating me hassles when I can choose my friends and my life. Is that good? I have no idea what time it is. Whoa, Jesus. Jesus. It's like the eternal service. So Father, we thank you for the spirit of sonship. I just pray, Lord, that some of the things I've shared this morning will really help people to develop deeper friendships, to become more accountable, and also to consider how they could father others and be sons and fathers simultaneously. We thank you, Lord, that all of us qualify as sons, that we're not the product of chance and time or a husband's decision, but we're the products of a father who is looking for children. And you've been adopted us into the beloved. Every one of us are equal sons, equal heirs with Jesus. And that just blows our mind. And so, Lord, I pray for healing this morning where people have memory of disappointed relationships and things that have gone sour. I thank you, Lord, that we can learn to trust again. Trust is ours to give, that we can learn to relate at a deeper level. Even if it takes months or years, we don't mind, Lord. We're in it for the long haul. And I just speak blessing over the sons and the fathers in this church. This will be a church of sons and fathers, and the sons will go further than the fathers. That'll be our delight. In Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. Thank you, guys. Let me finish off with this. One of the reasons why we finished at 12:30 is that we're starting to start late again. You notice that? Most of you wouldn't notice that because we started without you. But I want to ask you again. I did speak about this 6 months ago, and I just said, look, we want to start at 10. The people who tend to be here at 10 are visitors, and we dishonor them by our lateness. So please make an effort. Just say, Lord, if I'm part of the Jubilee family, I'm going to leave a bit earlier. I know parking's a hassle. I know that children can be troubling, but just put yourself out so that we can honor the people who come into this church that God sends to us to heal, to deliver, to set free, that we'll honor them by coming early, honor the musicians by being early, and we'll break the whole trend of Christendom in Australia and be the early church. Come on. Come on. Amen. That sounded really funny, the early church. What are you guys? We're the early church. They think we're talking about the Corinthians. No, no, no. We don't be like the Corinthians. They were getting drunk at the communion table. Come on. Bless you guys. We're going to have a ministry team up here. We're going to worship. Maybe just sign out your kids before you come up for ministry if you need ministry. But the ministry team is going to come up now and share words of knowledge if they have them. And so just be attentive. The team will lead us in some worship. And there's more. There's always more. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you on Saturday night. Charles Stock.